Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Donnellys, Powder Keg, 1840-1880, by John Little, narrated by Gareth Richards.
Shake, my boy. We don't have to go out in every rainstorm to wash the blood off our hands.
Bob Donnelly. Preface. It's 11 o'clock on Saturday, November 8th, 2014. My youngest son, Ben, and his South Muskoka Bears minor midget hockey team have just finished their first game of a tournament in St. Mary's, Ontario. They won their game and Ben scored a nice goal, so I'm happy. But the team's next game isn't until 2 o'clock that afternoon, so we're going to be doing a lot of sitting around until an hour or so before the next game. Ben understandably wants to hang out with his friends on the team during this interval, which means he's going to park himself at the arena. Consequently, I now find myself alone with 3 hours on my hands to fill. It occurs to me that I'm not that far from the Roman line. Maybe a 30-minute drive? I've always wanted to go there, as somewhere on that stretch of roadway sits the property upon which the Donnelly story played out. The infamous Donnelly children were raised on that lot of land, and 4 members of the family were murdered there on a cold February night in 1880. Despite being taught nothing of this bit of Southern Ontario history in school, when I first learned about the Donnellys, their story gripped me like few stories have before or since. Indeed, some 30 years previously, during my second year of university, a roommate had invited me to spend a weekend at his parents' home in Mitchell, Ontario. During the course of meeting his parents, we sat down at the family table to eat. Some small talk was exchanged, and then I posed a question that I thought would be a good icebreaker. How far away is Lucan? His father, a lawyer in town, answered, "Oh, about 30 minutes, not far. Are you interested in going to Lucan?" "Definitely," I replied enthusiastically. "Why?" he asked. "I understand that's where the Donnellys were killed," I replied. Although my statement was wrong, i.e. the Donnellys were killed within their farmhouse on the Roman line in Biddulph, not Lucan, which is about 4.5 miles southwest from where they lived. My enthusiasm was obvious, but then a look fell over the father's face that immediately let me know I would not be going to Lucan. "We don't talk about that here," he said, and the table fell quiet until someone introduced a subject that was evidently far less contentious. I never forgot that, and the father's attitude only served to further fan the flames of my nascent curiosity. So now, 30 years later, I find myself driving along Breen Drive, a country road in Biddulph Township, looking to intersect the infamous Roman Line concession road. Just my luck, it starts to rain, and the windshield wipers engage to sweep the water from my windshield. I keep looking left and right like I'm going to recognize something. Perhaps a big neon arrow with the words Donnelly Home Here will present itself. A stop sign looms up ahead, which causes me to slow down and then come to a complete stop. I must be lost. I hit the button to roll down the passenger side window of the truck to see if I can read the road sign that sits on my side of the small intersection, and there it is, the Roman line. I throw the truck in park and step out. There is the road that author Thomas P. Kelly, in his book The Black Donnellys, had said horses were afraid to run along at night after the murders had occurred. An old wives' tale, to be certain, but such tales have grown into legends that, rightly or wrongly, have become accepted as facts. There is a deep history to this road, and I am overtaken by the urge to stand right smack in the middle of it and take in the view. The weather has made it darker than it ought to be for a fall afternoon, but given the road's connection to violence and murder, it seems eerily appropriate. I return to the truck, turn right, and now find myself driving along the Roman line. I've called ahead to the man who presently owns the old Donnelly property, Robert Saltz. He's a retired schoolteacher who used to give tours on his plot of land. He lives in a house that was constructed on the property by 3 of the surviving Donnelly brothers back in 1881. The house has been added to over the years, but the original building still remains. He told me that he would be happy to sign a copy of his book about the property, You're Never Alone, for me, but he isn't feeling up to conducting any more tours. This is fine by me. I'm excited just to see the land. I pull up to the front of Lot 18 and immediately am taken by the fact that it was here, in this exact spot, that a group of 20, some would claim 40,
men came at 12:30 a.m. in the early morning hours of February 4, 1880, with the sole intent of murdering the Donnelly family. It's admittedly creepy, and the house looks creepy too. The dark sky and rain are simply augmenting the uncomfortableness of the experience. I leave the truck and knock on the door of the house, and Saltz invites me in. He's a nice person, so is his wife. After some talk, he presents me with a copy of his book, and I hand him some cash. I get the feeling that he'd rather I leave. I'm sure he's given the Donnelly talk thousands of times before, and since he's recently closed his property to tours, he's probably done with it. I'm fine with that, as I really just wanted to experience the place where it all went down. I ask if I can take a few photos from the driveway and roadway, to which he graciously consents. I snap away with my iPhone, photographing the exterior of the house and the Donnelly barn that was built by the brothers of the family sometime in the 1880s, and lifted onto a cement base by Bob Donnelly shortly after he acquired the property in 1905. I snap images of the field stones that are placed at distinct corners in the lawn beside the present house, said to mark the foundation of where the original Donnelly farmhouse stood. The area just in front of it is where Tom Donnelly, the youngest son, was beaten to death. In the corner of the property are the ruins of what once was the Donnelly schoolhouse, a place where the local children came to learn how to read and write. Across the road is nothing, although the Donnellys' neighbours used to have homes on the east side of the road. Nothing stands there anymore. The rain picks up, but that's okay, I've seen enough. Ben's game starts in an hour. I get back in my truck and turn it towards St. Mary's. I decide to take a different route on my way back to the arena and find myself passing St. Patrick's Church. This is cause to stop the truck again. St. Patrick's played host to the Donnelly family and those who killed them. They all attended church services here. Moreover, all but three of the Donnellys are buried in the church cemetery. It's worth braving the rain once more to pay my respects. St. Patrick's is a beautiful church with a huge wooden door that all the major players in the drama walked through at one time or another. Every member of the Donnelly family and all of their friends and all of their enemies came here to attend services, for confession, to attend family weddings and funerals. Father John Connolly, another major player in the story, once lived in the small stone rectory out back, and when he ventured inside for his sermons, he occasionally spoke out against the Donnelly family. After a while, I locate the headstone for the murdered family members. It's standard in size, at least compared to its predecessor, which was an 11-foot monument that stood over the grave like a sentinel for 70-some years, until it was replaced by this more modest offering in the mid-1960s, when the administrators of the church had grown tired of having endless streams of people tramping through their property and holding drinking vigils next to it. In any event, it's time to go. On the way back, my memories of what had piqued my interest in the Donnelly story return. I see my friend's father sternly telling me that the Donnellys were a subject that wasn't talked about in this area. 20 years before that, my sister Jane had read a passage to me from Kelly's book while at our dining room table in Agincourt, in which Joanna Donnelly, the matriarch of the family, walloped one of her sons in the back of the head with a cast-iron frying pan, laying him out cold on the farmhouse floor. And then there were the internet videos and the books on the subject I've read over the years. Books by Kelly, Orlo Miller and Ray Fazekas, with each providing a different perspective on the story. Such reading simply instilled a desire in me to dig deeper into the story, to find out who the Donnellys were as people, and to wonder how a sworn society could come into existence for the sole purpose of their destruction. From that day in 2014 until 2021, I have immersed myself in researching the Donnelly story in an attempt to answer these questions and to try get to know and understand the Donnellys. A 2-volume book series on the Donnelly story is the result. I must confess that authors have a bad habit when writing on historical subjects of taking sides or of advancing opinions that are thinly disguised as facts. This has been particularly evident in the Donnelly literature. I have fought that tendency in my writing and, at times when I have succumbed to the temptation, I have forewarned the listener, so my opinion on the matter is not mistaken for fact. Whenever possible, I have attempted to let the actual persons in the drama speak for themselves, as it is their story, after all. They were there when it transpired, I wasn't. And now, 7 years later, having researched the story as thoroughly as I could, I believe I have found the answers to my initial questions and gotten to understand the Donnelly family, as well as their enemies, a little better as well. The listener should further be forewarned that while we like clear-cut heroes and villains in our dramas, sometimes these roles oscillate. Very few people are pure evil, and none of them are saints. And so it is with the Donnellys and their enemies. Theirs is a human story, nothing more and nothing less. Like a saga from Norse mythology, there is nothing redeemable about the tale. It is a story about tough times and the tough people who lived in those times. It is a story about pride, perhaps most of all. Pride of family and pride of self, versus the threat that such pride poses to those outside of one's own group. There is no evidence that the murder of the Donnelly family was the culmination of a feud that was transported from the Emerald Isle, as Orlo Miller believed. It didn't need to be. It was a local problem that was dealt with locally, the particulars of which caused it to be discussed nationally, and then internationally. It's a story about ostensibly good, hard-working people who ended up doing bad things, primarily out of the fear of a monster of their own making. The shocking thing about the murders is that they could easily happen again, with another group of good people, if the environment in which they live is allowed to develop in the same way it did around the Donnelly family. It points out the powder keg that lies dormant within human beings, that requires but a few strikes of stone against flint to produce the single spark that will set it off. John Little, Bracebridge, Ontario, 2021. Prologue. Bob Donnelly had not slept at all during the night. It hadn't been the moaning and inhuman howling that echoed intermittently through the corridors that had kept him awake. There was danger afoot. Somebody was planning to kill him. There was a plot being hatched at that very moment to cut off his head and burn his body until there was nothing left but charred bones. At least, that's what Bob Donnelly sincerely believed as he paced within his room at the London Asylum for the Insane in the early morning hours of June 24, 1908. Unlike most of the patients committed in this institution, however, his delusion had its basis in fact. Indeed, had he experienced these same thoughts 28 years earlier, they wouldn't have been delusions at all. He had, after all, ended up serving 2 years in prison as a result of people lying under oath to have him sent away. And then there had been the successful plot that resulted in the brutal murder of his family and the destruction of the family home. The last time he had seen his parents, or what had once been his parents, he was looking at a small assortment of scorched bones that had been placed within a small wooden box. There had been no skulls among the remains. Those had already been stolen by the very community that had murdered them. When the sun rose above the surrounding fields several hours later, an asylum attendant, of whom we know little, save for his surname Reed, walked from his dormitory on the grounds of the institution and began his morning inspection of the patients' rooms within the various wards of several buildings on the compound. The London Asylum for the Insane housed patients who suffered from various conditions, ranging from those who were merely depressed or anxious, to the seriously delusional, the homicidal, the suicidal, and even those who had been considered too open in the expression of their sexuality for the tastes of Victorian Ontario. Those beyond remedy or who were otherwise unable to care for themselves were kept in a locked ward within the North Building. Others, who were almost self-sufficient, lived within one of three cottages, which were simply three adjoined buildings, each three stories high, that housed a total of 180 patients. The main building of the asylum had its own wards and private rooms, as did the infirmary or reception hospital. In time, Attendant Reed arrived at the infirmary building and eventually worked his way through its three floors to the door of patient number 5924, the room of Bob Donnelly. Reed opened the door and stepped inside, but was surprised to discover that the patient was not in his bed. What happened next surprised him even more. Bob Donnelly launched an 11-pound spittoon at the attendant, which hit Reed with such force in the shoulder that he thought his arm had been broken. The terrified attendant quickly bolted from the room, slammed the door behind him and locked it shut. Wincing as he held his throbbing shoulder, he ran along the corridor and down the stairs to the medical superintendent's office. After having his shoulder examined and discovering to his relief that his arm wasn't fractured, Reed, along with Dr. Foster and a phalanx of attendants, returned to Bob Donnelly's room. Donnelly seemed even more disturbed, but he must have calmed down at some point, perhaps his hours of agitation and sleeplessness having finally caught up with him. As Dr. Foster was able to convince him to go back to bed without further incident. As a result of what had transpired earlier, however, Bob Donnelly was flagged as a potential problem for which more serious measures might be required in the event that he should become violent again. His family and friends had all agreed that Bob Donnelly's personality was not what it used to be. The change had begun 6 months previously, in December, when he'd started to withdraw from social contact. He seemed depressed, but over time that depression in turn gave way to episodes of anxiety and finally, paranoia. His wife Annie and his nephew James had noticed this change in behaviour and grew increasingly concerned for the man for whom they cared so deeply. Bob Donnelly had noticed the change as well, and it scared him. What scared him most was that he seemed no longer able to control his emotional state. It was as if a huge wave had picked him up and was carrying him in a direction he didn't wish to go, but he was powerless to stop it. He had first been admitted to the asylum for a brief stay back in April. It was agreed by all that his getting out of Lucan and into a facility that sat upon 300 acres of land in the country and was populated by doctors of various specialities might be good for him. His family refused to consider that he was suffering from some form of mental illness, and instead believed he was in the grip of something perhaps environmental. Consequently, they weren't sending him to a facility for lunatics and idiots, but rather a sanitarium, a place where he could go and convalesce for a few weeks. His stay during this time had not resulted in any real change in his condition, but it hadn't got any worse either. The doctors thought his stay had done him good. They were wrong. Not long after his release, his depression returned with a vengeance. He attempted to kill himself on two occasions. Admittedly, the attempts were poor, but they suggested that whatever his problem was, it hadn't gone away, but had gotten worse. And when, during a fit of delusion, he had threatened his wife physically, Annie and James decided that a longer stay in the asylum might be necessary. His condition having now reached a crisis point, Bob, together with his wife and nephew, had gone to see Dr. James Sutton, a local doctor who practiced out of Clandeboye and Lucan, for an official assessment, which was a requisite for long-term admittance to the London Asylum for the Insane. Sutton's assessment was as follows. Appearance: melancholy, dull, and ill. Conduct: pays little attention, does not care to converse and inattentive. Conversation: only answers questions when asked, and is not talkative. Needing certificates from two medical doctors in order for Bob Donnelly to meet the qualifications for a protracted stay in the asylum, they next took him to be assessed by Dr. Thomas Hossack, a man who had known Bob Donnelly and his family for decades. He evaluated his old friend thusly. Appearance: usually friendly and cheerful, now sullen, tries to hide away, suspicious of everybody, very nervous. Conduct: wants to remain continually in bed, slovenly in his habits. Conversation: refuses to talk, only in monosyllables. Both physicians further noted in their assessment certificates that Donnelly's wife and nephew had confided in them about his attempts to take his life. Sutton wrote that Donnelly has lost interest in everything, has made several ineffectual attempts to destroy himself, fancies everything about him is going to ruin, told me by his nephew, James Donnelly, who has been looking after him since he has been going wrong. Hossack wrote, attempted to destroy himself by pushing rags down his throat, also attempted to get poison, told to me by his wife and nephew, James Donnelly, who lives with him. Of the two medical assessments, Dr. Sutton's was by far the more thorough and fascinating, as it included a list of 56 questions that were posed to and answered by Bob Donnelly, such as, has the patient exhibited any marked mental peculiarity recently or in early life? Brutal worry since the tragedy. What has been the patient's habits as regards sleep when considered well? Has there been any recent insomnia? A good sleeper until his recent trouble. What has been the patient's habits as to the use of A. alcoholic stimulants, B. narcotic drugs, opium, etc.? Very temperate so far as to alcoholic stimulants. Never used drugs. What appears to have been the exciting cause or causes of the present attack? Was there, in addition to changes in general health, any mental or moral shock? Any loss, great grief or disappointment? Any overwork or overstrain? The tragedy was the first shock, which seemed to have troubled him more or less continually since. What were the first mental symptoms observed? Depression or excitement? Depression. Any loss of memory, defects in judgment, confusion or self-accusation? Loss of memory, defects in judgment, confusion, no self-accusation. Have the mental changes been progressive and regular, or have they suddenly varied, the patient at times seeming much better or the contrary? Progressing regularly. What are the changes which have taken place in patient's mental and physical symptoms since the commencement of the attack? Delusive fancies, voice much changed, walking unsteady, no fainting nor loss of consciousness, no convulsions, no paralysis, nor impairment of any set of muscles. Has the patient shown any appreciation of the changes in his mental condition? Yes. Has suicide or violence to others been threatened or attempted? Suicide. Has attempted violence to his wife. Are the facts bearing on the case in the patient's past or present history? Sometimes very excitable. It's clear from Dr. Sutton's notes that Donnelly's reaction to the tragedy had been a brutal worry that had troubled him more or less continually ever since. The tragedy referred to was, of course, the murder of his family, which had occurred in the early morning hours of February 4th, 1880, some 28 years earlier. Despite his always having been a tough, hard-working man, Bob Donnelly was the taciturn one of the family. His parents had raised him to never display emotions that could be perceived as soft, particularly in the company of the Donnelly family's many enemies. This would be showing them your weak spot, and thus inviting them to strike at it. Indeed, at the wake of his parents, two brothers and niece, Bob Donnelly had been overcome by emotion, whereupon his older brother William had pulled him aside until he calmed down. But William had been dead now for 11 years, and ever since his passing, Bob Donnelly's suppressed grief and rage at the tragedy had slowly started bubbling toward the surface of his emotions, until he was no longer able to control them. It was concluded by the doctors that Bob Donnelly would be a danger both to himself and to others if he remained on the outside. The London Asylum for the Insane seemed a practical choice, as it was only 16.25 miles south of Lucan, making it the closest asylum to where his family lived. The Hamilton Asylum was 95 miles away, the Toronto Asylum 120, and Kingston 273, all to the east. Its proximity to Lucan made Donnelly's relatives comfortable, knowing that he was only a few hours' travel away by wagon, or in the winter, sleigh, meaning that they could still see him from time to time. It was for the best. The asylum patient's accommodation, food and treatment was, for the most part, paid for by the Government of Ontario. But those patients or their families who could afford to pay to have a family member institutionalised were charged between $1.50 and $2.75 a week for a private room. Bob Donnelly had money, and so he fell into the latter category. He had been the most successful financially of all the Donnelly brothers. Covering the cost of his stay was not an issue. And so, at the stroke of midnight on June 15th, a mere 9 days prior to his attack on attendant Reed, Bob Donnelly was admitted to the asylum's infirmary building, which would be his home for the next 6 months. He was an older man now, having turned 55 in October. He no longer knew his actual date of birth with any degree of precision, nor those of any of his family members. as all the family records had perished along with his parents' home when it had gone up in flames in 1880. His hair had thinned quite a bit. He was starting to go bald on the top of his head, and there were flecks of grey in his moustache and beard. His ward admission record noted that he had sores on back of neck, top of head, backs of hands, shins and feet. Also scars from old sores. The clothing he had packed for his stay was modest. One hat, one overcoat, one coat, one vest, one pair of pants, one pair of shoes, two pairs of socks, one nightshirt, two coloured shirts, two undershirts, two pairs of underwear, one tie, one pair of suspenders, five handkerchiefs, and a small handbag within which these items had been packed. The clothes, the attendant said, were clean and fairly good. Donnelly himself was said to appear clean but not very well nourished. In his pockets he was carrying one pair of buttons for the cuffs of his shirts, and two collar buttons. The Donnelly brothers had always prided themselves on wearing respectable clothing. While the main building of the asylum had opened in 1870, the infirmary where Bob Donnelly would be staying wouldn't be completed until 1903. It had initially been used as the medical examination building on the compound, but by 1908 its function had changed to that of reception hospital, where new patients could be admitted, examined, and housed in either dormitories or individual rooms within the building. The infirmary was an imposing structure, 3 stories high plus a basement area. It was constructed with yellow bricks on its exterior, and its 3 floors were interconnected by wooden stairways with railings. It had its own sunroom and dining area, and a surgical suite on its top level. In short, the infirmary was considered to be the perfect building for patients who would be staying short-term within the institution, which could be anywhere from 2 months to 2 years. The infirmary was only one of the buildings on the compound. The main building was very much a structure of its time, Gothic Revival in style, with steep angled gable roofs, lancet windows and yellow bricks, and set squarely within some 300 acres that lay just on the fringe of the London city limits. Other buildings on the grounds included a chapel, a mortuary, a few workshops, a barn and a bakery. The attendants and medical superintendent lived on the property, making them always available for any emergencies that should crop up. The asylum's superintendent was Dr. William John Robinson, a well-decorated physician, winning the University Gold Medal and the Star Gold Medal in his final year of studying medicine at the Toronto School of Medicine, who had practiced privately in Arthur prior to moving to Guelph, where he would become the health officer for that city. He then moved on to London, where he would become the superintendent of the Ontario Hospital of London, as well as the head of psychiatry in their Department of Medicine. In 1908, Robinson had taken over as the medical superintendent of the Asylum for the Insane from Dr. George McCallum, who in turn had taken over the position in 1902 from Dr. Richard Morris Buke. In retrospect, if not at the time, Buke had had some dangerously bizarre and gruesome ideas regarding the treatment of certain mental disorders, particularly among the female patients at the asylum. Believing there to be a direct connection between displaced or damaged reproductive organs and insanity, he oversaw over 106 surgeries performed on women patients from 1895 to 1898. There was, of course, no link ever discovered between the uterus and insanity, and Buke's superintendentship marked the darkest point in the history of the London Asylum for the Insane. It was not a coincidence that after his departure from the asylum, the number of gynecological surgeries diminished substantially. And while Dr. Buke and his gruesome treatments had been gone from the hospital for 8 years by the time of Bob Donnelly's arrival, the doctors believed that the body and its internal organs had a direct link to the state of one's mental health was one that would endure. If one's emotional health was off kilter, the solution, it was believed, lay in treating the body. At the London Asylum, this treatment typically consisted of hydrotherapy. Water, because it could be heated or cooled, could impact patients in different ways. Warm water was believed to help cure insomnia, Cold water was said to be a tonic for manic depressive behaviour. Baths were thus frequently administered to patients, lasting over a period of hours to several days. If baths didn't take, then water would be applied via spraying the patient continuously over a period of time, or by packs, soaking towels in either very cold, 48 degrees Fahrenheit to 70 degrees Fahrenheit, or warm water, 92 degrees Fahrenheit to 97 degrees Fahrenheit, and wrapping them around the patient. Often the patient who displayed excitement and increased motor activity would be wrapped in the cold, wet blankets, and straps would be fastened around them for immobilization and to prevent the patient from removing the towels. The patient would then be left this way for hours at a time, in the belief that this therapy slowed blood flow to the brain and would thus help to elicit compliance. You did not want to draw attention to yourself in the London Asylum for the Insane. As Bob Donnelly had been removed from his home several days before he had been taken to the asylum, Annie and James were both understandably worried about him. On June 15th, James wrote a letter to the institution inquiring about visiting his uncle. "Dear Doc, just a line asking you to let me know at your first opportunity how Uncle Robert is getting along and how he takes it. Aunt is very anxious and uneasy about him. You will kindly let me know also if you think it will do any harm in calling on him and oblige. Yours sincerely, James Donnelly." Dr. Robinson replied from London on June 18th. "Dear Sir, in reply to your letter on June 15th, I beg to state that Mr. Donnelly's condition is little changed since his admission. He is quite fretful and despondent, yet I would prefer that the friends do not visit him for a while yet while he is in this despondent mood. Yours truly, W.J. Robinson, Medical Superintendent." Despite what concerns had been expressed in the medical superintendent's letter, it hadn't really looked as though Bob Donnelly was going to pose any problem for the institution. His symptoms were still present, but manageable. He was by no means a model patient, but it was sincerely supposed by the asylum's doctors and staff that Donnelly's next several months in the institution might well work wonders. Or so it was believed. Until the restlessness and anxiety set in, and continued to build until the incident of June 24th, and it wasn't over yet. Somewhere around 3 o'clock in the afternoon on June 27th, the paranoia returned. Bob Donnelly once again detected the presence of evil around him and became convinced that somebody was going to try to kill him. Initially, he was convinced that fire would be the assassin's weapon of choice and that he would be burned. Later, he was certain that the plan was to seal him in a coffin, which would then be placed in the cellar of the asylum. Once word got out about his latest delusions, the attendants showed up en masse and attempted to physically restrain him. Donnelly fought back, struggling and shouting. Finally, the attendants overpowered him and sedated him with hyoscine, which was used at the asylum to induce sleep in excitable individuals and insomniacs. The drug did its job quickly. Donnelly's resistance weakened long enough for the attendants to drag him to the hydrotherapy room, where they wrapped him tightly in a cold pack. He was left, completely immobilized and shivering, wrapped like a mummy from feet to neck within the cold towels and secured by restraining straps. He yelled for help repeatedly to no avail. He then yelled out in frustration and agony. His teeth chattered and his body shook almost to the point of convulsing. One of the attendants had seen enough, writing in his report, "Seemed inhuman to hold him in the pack against his terrible resistance, and he was taken out. His heart was throbbing. He was dressed and was to be taken out in the airing cord at the NB, the north building where the genetically incurable were housed. But he became quiet on the way and sat and watched the cricket game. He was restless that night till 2 a.m. and said he wanted some toast carried up to his wife. He was given a bath and then slept 4 hours. The day after this entry was filed, the same nameless attendant wrote, "His condition has been much relieved ever since." This evidently would remain the case, as there exists nothing in Bob Donnelly's psychiatric asylum files to indicate that he suffered from any more delusions that summer, nor that he required any additional hydrotherapy. In mid-September, after repeated written requests from James Donnelly to allow his uncle to come home for a brief visit, Dr. Robinson finally acquiesced. Bob Donnelly would be allowed to return home on probation for a period of 2 months. James was to keep oversight of his uncle, and also send to Dr. Robinson a fortnightly account of his condition, both mental and physical. And so, on September 19, 1908, Bob Donnelly went home. And on September 28, 1908, Bob Donnelly went AWOL. The London Free Press reported the story. Lucan, September 28. Robert Donnelly, one of the surviving members of the Donnelly family of Biddulph, who has been unwell for the past year and now returned from the asylum at London 10 days ago, somewhat improved, disappeared from his home in this village at 3 o'clock Monday morning. And since then no trace of him has been found, although search parties were out 20 minutes after he had gone. Mr. Donnelly is aged 55 years, but in appearance has grown much older during the past few months. His face bears a 10 days' growth of beard and a scar on the left cheek. He was scantily attired, having hurriedly dressed himself under the pretense of stepping outside for a few minutes. At the time he was being closely watched, and was seen to scale the picket fence at the rear of the lot. A moment later his nephew was in pursuit, but the morning was intensely dark and no trace of him could be found. He wore only a pair of trousers, an undershirt, a pair of house slippers without socks, and a light-coloured fedora hat. It is thought he may be heading for Glencoe, his former home. That Bob Donnelly was now on the loose was obviously of concern to a great many people, friends and foes alike. He was a Donnelly, after all, and that name still meant something in and around London, Ontario. But how had it come to this? A once proud and feared man, still dangerous to be certain, but now deeply delusional and running somewhere about the township of Biddulph in a fedora and slippers. To better understand what led to Bob Donnelly's rather erratic behaviour at such a late stage in his life, it will first be necessary to travel back in time, to the morning of the tragedy, February 4th, 1880. For that was the day Bob Donnelly's world changed, and an entire nation lost its moral innocence upon the world stage. Chapter 1. The Morning After. The city of London sits almost exactly 120 miles between Detroit, Michigan, and Toronto, Ontario. Some locals call it the Forest City, because it required a considerable clearing of forest when it was founded back in 1826. It had once been pegged to be the capital of Upper Canada, but the War of 1812 had made this position untenable, particularly after the United States had invaded Hungerford Hill, now Reservoir Hill in southwest London. The province of Canada fought back, with its British soldiery invading the District of Columbia and setting fire to the Capitol, the Treasury and the White House, among other buildings. It remains an impressive wartime accomplishment, making it the only time since the American Revolutionary War that a foreign power has ever captured and occupied the capital of the United States. Prior to this very momentary claim to fame, the region that became London had been populated by First Nations peoples. The Odawa, Neutral and Ojibwe, until the Beaver Wars in 1654, when the Iroquois rose up and drove all competing bands from the area. And then the Europeans arrived, and finished off what the Iroquois had started, driving out the Iroquois and all remaining native bands from the territory. Apart from the Pleistocene glaciers, the silt and the clay, a fair bit of human blood gave shape and substance to the land that would become London. The stamp of its British namesake still imprints the city. It has a Thames River, a Covent Garden Market, a Blackfriars Bridge, a Victoria Park, an Oxford Street and a Piccadilly Street, just to remind Canadians that they weren't always a nation unto themselves. The English influence accelerated civilization in the region, such that by the 19th century, London was about as cosmopolitan a city as Upper Canada could get. The spiritual needs of its approximate population of 18,000 were served by churches of all the major denominations. Its financial requirements were looked after by the foremost banking institutions of the day, and apart from horse and wagon, entrance and egress to the city were served by two railway lines, the Great Western and the Grand Trunk. There were two breweries, Labatt's and Carling, and refineries, insurance companies, foundries and tanneries. The city further boasted two newspapers, the London Advertiser, a morning paper, and the London Free Press, an evening paper, to keep its populace informed of the daily goings-on within both London and its neighbouring townships. And until February 4, 1880, the biggest news story to hit London had been the fire of 1845, which destroyed one-fifth of the city, laying waste to 150 buildings, along with the town's only fire engine, and torching the better part of 30 acres of land. It was said to be the province's first million-dollar fire. After February 4th, however, another story would come to the columns of the London newspapers, and it would remain on their front pages for many months to come. It was a story of the massacre of a local family. A story so out of place for the Federation of Canada. The new country had been granted sovereignty of a sort 13 years earlier, with the British North American Act of 1867, and so grisly in its details that it would soon be picked up by newspapers throughout the Federation and by certain cities within the United States. The story would be covered for the London Free Press by a 21-year-old reporter named John Lambert Payne, who shortly after learning of the news the morning of February 4th had climbed aboard a stagecoach and headed north to visit the scene of the crime. The stage left London along the Proof Line Road, an icy gravel thoroughfare that extended for the better part of 18 miles. It could not have been a pleasant ride, as the destination lay 3.5 hours away and required travel over deeply rutted country roads. Periodically, both the stage and its occupants would shift and pitch violently as the wheels of the coach caught the odd furrow. In looking out through the windows, the reporter would have seen nothing but snow-covered farmers' fields, and beyond these, nothing but flat lands that stretched on for miles and led nowhere. His editor told him that the murders had taken place within a farmhouse that sat somewhere along the Roman line, a stretch of roadway also known as the Chapel Line, as it led ultimately to St. Patrick's Church in the township of Biddulph. The Roman line was a concession road. More technically, it was called Concession Road 6, one of many such roads in Upper Canada, the primary function of which was to provide access to already surveyed but yet undeveloped government land, which had been made available to new settlers for the purpose of farming. Concession Road 6 had acquired the epithet Roman Line in deference to the fact that a large number of Irish Roman Catholic families that had immigrated to Ontario had opted to settle along either side of it. The road itself extended a little over 8.5 miles, and somewhere along that stretch was the farmhouse in which the murders had occurred. It would be Payne's task to find out where. There were 3 toll gates set up along the Proof Line Road, each spaced exactly 5 miles apart, that required all traffic to stop briefly in order to pay the levies. The first 2 stops that morning had been momentary, hardly requiring the stagecoach driver to slow down at all. However, by the time the stage had reached the final gate, there was a lineup of sleighs, cutters, and wagons waiting to pass through. Around the booth, a small group had congregated, and as Payne's stage drew closer, the reporter could pick up on snippets of conversation he heard coming from outside the coach. Someone from within the assembly turned to another and asked, "Have you heard about the awful affair at the Donnellys?" Before the person could answer, another voice from the crowd piped up that they were smashed to pieces and burned, and we have just heard that another of the brothers was called out of his house over beyond and shot dead. Word about the murders was now clearly a matter of common knowledge among the local population. Within minutes, the stage was clear of the toll gate and rattling its way north through Ryan's Corners, and then gradually easing west until it reached the base of the Roman line. To Payne's surprise, an inordinate number of horse-drawn conveyances were on the road now, all apparently heading in the same direction that he was. Each wagon and carriage appeared to the reporter to be crowded to its fullest capacity. The stagecoach passed by St. Patrick's Church, which was and remains a parish that had been tending to the spiritual needs of Biddulph Township since the 1850s, and then continued on its way north along the Roman line. Into view came small and simple farmhouses, most being single-level, constructed of hand-hewn timbers, and all, it seemed, with green-painted doors. The occupants within these dwellings could be seen staring out of their windows at the small caravan of wagons and sleighs that passed by. It had been 30 minutes since the stage had left the final toll gate when it finally came to a stop in front of Lot 18 on the west side of the Roman line, the location where the murders had taken place. Looking out from the stagecoach, Payne noted that a multitude of people were milling about the property. He stepped from the conveyance and watched as it slowly pulled away. The people on the property stood together in muted awe before the ghastly spectacle that lay before their eyes. The smouldering remains of what had once been the Donnelly family home. The reporter walked closer and observed the still smoking outline of the floor of the farmhouse. It formed a perfect square. Less than 100 yards to the west of the home stood the deceased family's stables, granary and barn, all of which looked to have been untouched by the blaze. It appeared as if time had stood still for this section of the property. The fence that lined this plot of land was also in excellent condition, and the fields of the property revealed themselves to have been well worked over a period of many decades. There was not a stump to be seen. Even the farm animals, pigs, horses and cattle, were still in their pens and stalls. Some were seen meandering about the property as if nothing out of the ordinary had occurred. The horses, for example, could be seen pulling at straw from a large stack that stood near the granary, clearly oblivious to the tragedy that had befallen the owners of the property only hours earlier. This juxtaposition of life and death was surreal. Pastoral splendour and 20 yards east of it, the grisliest horror scene that one could imagine. As Payne would later recall, every vestige of the old log house was destroyed, and the smoke which was emitted rose rather from the baked ground than any inflammable material which remained. The first object to excite attention was in the ruins of the old-fashioned kitchen stove, in the northwest corner of the smoking plot, and a black mass lying beside it. The reporter advanced closer to the ruins, where he quickly discovered that the black mass he had observed from afar was in fact the charred remains of not one, but two human beings. Human beings that had been burned so severely that they were now black, unrecognizable, and ghastly. In assessing the scene, Payne surmised that they had evidently been piled together against the log wall, but beyond the ash-colored skulls and the upper trunk, no outline of a single body could be drawn from the charred mass. The arms and legs were gone, but one or two ribs remained, and with the exception of a single lung, there was but few traces of flesh. On the surface of the upper body lay a warped pocket knife, which showed that this remnant of a human form once contained the soul of James Donnelly, father of the family and owner of the property. The skull of the other corpse was broken in pieces, and some of its fragments scattered 3 feet away, yet a sufficient portion remained intact to be distinguishable. 10 feet further south on the border of the cellar, but within the area covered by the little kitchen, lay another corpse burned to an even smaller crisp than the one just referred to. The skull was broken, but the fracture did not indicate whether it had been done by a falling beam or some instrument in the hands of the murderers. A few rags of tweed showed this to be the remains of Thomas Donnelly, a son of the murdered father. Within a few feet of where the front door stood, and on the surface of a smoking pile of potatoes, lay another sickening remnant of humanity. This body could not be reached without the aid of a ladder, but from the upper ground it could be seen that the fire had left the trunk more complete than in any of the other 3 cases. The extremities, however, could not be traced, and the skull appeared as though it had been buried in the ground for years, and through that agency had been thoroughly bleached and dried. It should be noted at this point that while the reporter's testimony was truthful, Payne had been mistaken in one detail that he could not possibly have known, and that wouldn't be disclosed until the trials that would eventually follow. The corpse with the few rags of tweed had in fact been that of Joanna Donnelly, the 56-year-old matriarch of the Donnelly clan. The corpse of Thomas Donnelly, who at 25 years of age was the youngest son of James and Joanna, was the one Payne had spied lying on its back on the potato pile in the root cellar. But this aside, and upon further survey of the wreckage, Payne would go on to note even more pitiful and peculiar artifacts. Next to the charred body of James Donnelly was the head of an axe, as well as metal buttons from a jacket that the Donnelly family patriarch had been wearing at the time he was killed, and next to those, a pair of spectacles and a small amount of money, a quarter, a dime and a penny. In the most easterly portion of what would have been the kitchen, next to the skull of Mrs. Donnelly, was the grotesque sight of ringlets from a portion of her still-preserved hair, which had been held in shape by the ash that had surrounded it. Beneath the body that lay upon its back in the vegetable cellar could be seen the blade of a spade. The iron strap that had once secured it to a wooden handle was visible, although its wooden handle had perished in the flames. Discernible on the top of this corpse were more metal buttons, as well as the buckles from a pair of suspenders. These metal objects had been seared into the corpse once its clothing had caught on fire. A pocket watch on a chain was also visible next to the body. The only evidence of what had once been the outer walls of the home were shards of broken glass from the several windows in the establishment that had blown out during the conflagration, along with some screws and nails that had been in the support beams and trusses. In among the debris were other artifacts. A tin dish and the spout of a shattered china teapot were observed poking out from among the ashes. Within what had once been one of the bedrooms were the scorched remains of a rifle, a shotgun and three revolvers, the stocks and handles having burned away. The family had clearly perceived that a threat upon their lives had been imminent, but had been surprised by the attack, as the guns were nowhere near the bodies. Several axe heads were noted lying within the ruins, as well as a pick and a hammer, objects that typically would not have been brought into the home by its owners. And finally, the reporter's eyes came to rest upon a metal latch, still in the unlocked position, that had once served to secure the Donnelly's front door. Then Payne noted an object that intrigued him. Next to one of the charred corpses, and within what had been the little kitchen area, he saw a small, shiny lump of metal and glass. He walked over and picked it up. It was still warm to the touch. Turning the object over in his hand, it dawned on him that what he was now looking at was all that remained of Mrs. Donnelly's eyeglasses. For reasons known only to himself, he then placed the object in his pocket and continued his trek through the ruins. Perhaps one of the spectators had taken notice of Payne's petty pilfering, as soon other items began to disappear. The head of a shovel that had earlier been observed lying beneath the skull of James Donnelly, perhaps one of the murder weapons employed on that fateful night, as the Donnellys had no need for a shovel in their kitchen, would vanish at some point during the next 24 hours. A neighbour would also observe another neighbour lifting Tom Donnelly's gold watch and chain from his carbonised body. And the thefts became more macabre. Some of the skulls and teeth of the victims would soon be spirited away. And such ghoulish thefts weren't limited to just the human interlopers, as one of the most shocking acts occurred when a neighbouring dog arrived on the scene, having lately picked up on the scent of burning flesh, and within minutes was seen tugging on the remains of an exposed lung from one of the victims. Eventually working it free, the animal ran off from the ruins with the charred organ hanging from its mouth. The dog would later be tracked down and shot by someone. While Payne's perambulation of the property had revealed the extreme carnage that had befallen the late Donnelly family, it also revealed something else. A rather large number of footprints, clearly visible in the snow, that, as far as he could ascertain, had not been made by any of the looky-loos who had assembled there that morning. But surely this was a problem for the local constables to puzzle over once they arrived on the scene, not a junior reporter working on his first big story. As he reached what had been the front of the Donnelly home, Payne observed that the snow in this area was melted for a good 20 feet or so, a consequence of the intense heat from the fire. Once again he saw numerous sets of footprints bordering the area, and then his eyes caught sight of something else entirely. It looked to be a small pool of blood. It was hard to discern the quantity of it at first glance, as someone had placed boards across it, obviously an attempt to conceal it from public view. He bent down and lifted the boards to look beneath, and discovered that they had in fact been concealing a very large pool of blood. Replacing the boards, the reporter turned and continued to walk about the property. As he did so, he picked up on a strange attitude that seemed to be shared by members of the crowd. He would later write that, Those above the ruins spoke in whispers, and no one even wanted the names of the probable perpetrators. Although hundreds visited the scene during the day, the affair was spoken of as a mystery. Payne eventually made his way across the road and noticed even more footprints heading north along the roadway. Also across the road stood a large farmhouse. Spying a man walking in front of the home, the young reporter approached him to ask a few questions. The man, John Whalen, was 34 years old, and like most of the people who lived on the Roman line, a farmer by profession, he shared with the reporter what he knew of the fire at his neighbour's home.
About 2 o'clock this morning, I was awakened by my little one crying, and on rising, I noticed a bright red light streaming in through the window. I said to the old woman, "There is a fire!" And on running to the door, I saw it was the Donnelly's place. The fire was breaking out by the windows, and yet I saw no one about, and could hear no other sounds than the crackling of the fire. After waiting for nearly half an hour, during which time I dressed, I went over to Donnelly's and found the back kitchen burned down, but the front portion of the house was still blazing. There were no neighbours about, and it was 4 hours afterwards, when the fire had burned out, that the bodies were found. I saw the marks of blood at the front door, but did not know whether the Donnellys had been killing pigs or how it came there. I went over to my father's house. His father and mother, Patrick and Anne Whalen, lived about 40 yards away alongside the same road, and found a small boy there who was frightened almost to death. He came to my father's house about 2 o'clock in the morning. After waking the inmates up, he told them the Donnellys' place was on fire. After being in the house for some time, he said he guessed some of them were killed, and there had been a great fight, and the bodies of the old man Donnelly, the old woman, Tom, and Bridget Donnelly had been left in the house. We saw by the bodies the boy was right. I have lived a neighbour to James Donnelly for a great many years, but with the exception of one little quarrel, have always been on the best terms with the whole family. I believe, however, that the people hereabouts were afraid of them. The people, it seems, were currently afraid of a lot of things. Years later, Payne would write, "I can recall the excitement and fear which gripped the whole countryside, nor have I forgotten the glowering looks that were cast upon me as I sought information along the Roman line." Nevertheless, the news he had been given about the boy was certainly intriguing, as it revealed that there had been an eyewitness to the murders. Moreover, at this point, what the boy had seen was known only to a handful of people. Indeed, the police would not hear of it for another several hours, but by then the whole country would know about the crime. Payne wrapped up his interview with John Whalen and returned to the Donnelly property. On the northwest corner of the lot, he took notice of a modest building that evidently was a schoolhouse. Indeed, it was referred to locally as the Donnelly School, as the land upon which it sat had been donated by the Donnelly parents to the township of Biddulph in 1861. There were no classes today, however, as the teachers and children who had arrived at the school earlier this morning had been shocked by the fact that the neighbouring Donnelly house had burned down during the night. Naturally curious, the school children had climbed the short fence that served to separate the late family's farm from the schoolhouse and meandered through the property to get a look at the carnage. With more people coming to the property every hour, Payne decided to take his leave. He still had another murder scene to visit that morning. John Donnelly, the 33-year-old son of the old couple who had met their end in the horrific fire on the Roman line, had been visiting his brother William at the latter's home. There he had been shot, by whom or for what reason wasn't known presently. Payne, however, was determined to find out what he could about the matter. After all, that John's murder coincided with the massacre of his family couldn't have been an accident. And so he next travelled to an intersection of two concession roads that was referred to locally as Whalen's Corners. This destination, 3 miles to the northeast, required travel by sleigh over bumpy, stump-covered side roads. The ride took the better part of 45 minutes, but he soon found himself standing before the home of William Donnelly, the second oldest child of James and Joanna. According to Payne, on the 8th and 9th concessions of the same township, in a clump of houses which imparts to that portion of the road the appearance of a little village, is situated the residence of William Donnelly, eldest surviving son of the murdered James. The house is a frame one, and was once a neat little white-painted Gothic building, but the storms of a dozen years have worn off the paint and left it pretty much in the condition of other buildings in that neighbourhood. within 10 feet on either side are buildings, and neighbours are near and numerous. There are 4 entrances to the building, which seems to have been added to at different times, and externally presents an uneven appearance. It is what would be considered in any locality a comfortable and perhaps a cosy dwelling.
The reporter soon heard the sound of voices coming from behind the house. Walking in the direction of the voices, he noticed that a group of men were gathered in a small laneway at the rear of the building. As he approached, he overheard them discussing the shooting that had taken place. At the right side of the house was a side door that led into what looked to be a large kitchen. A portion of the roof projected out and over the entranceway, offering some present protection from the elements. As the door was already open, he ventured up the steps and was about to enter when he abruptly stopped himself in his tracks. Smeared on the floor before him was a large trail of blood, which led from the doorway through the kitchen and into what looked to be a side bedroom. With cautious steps so as to avoid the bloody trail, Payne tracked the pathway of the smeared blood into a bedroom where, stretched out on the floor before him, lay the body of the deceased. It was a gruesome sight. Lying on his back and partially covered with a quilt, his face and familiar curly hair were easily distinguished.
A rough working shirt and an undergarment were turned back, exposing to view a breast punctured by 26 dark blood-clotted holes.
His face was marked with blood, and on the floor was a large pool of the same crimson fluid. Clasped tightly within the victim's lifeless hands was what was left of a blessed candle, which had been placed there before the deceased had drawn his last breath. Presently, a woman entered the room, Nora Donnelly, the wife of William Donnelly, and the sister-in-law of the deceased. She appeared somewhat taken aback by the sight of a complete stranger in her home. With apologies for the intrusion, Payne introduced himself.
The woman seemed somewhat relieved to learn he was simply a reporter from London.
When he inquired if she could tell him anything about what had happened to cause the death of her brother-in-law, Nora had explained that his death had been a case of mistaken identity, as Payne would later report. Although his, John's, home was with the old people, James and Joanna Donnelly, he had been away for several days, and had dropped in at his brother's house after nightfall. Presumably the object of the lynchers was to kill William, the most hated member of the family, and John's presence in his brother's home was unknown to them. When the sleeping household was aroused, John went to the door while his sister-in-law held a lamp. As he opened the door, a charge of buckshot caught him in the breast, and he fell dead. Payne asked the grieving woman if her husband was at home. She shook her head no. William had ridden his horse to the house of a friend, and then was going to report the murder to the local authorities. Not wanting to disturb Mrs. Donnelly any more than he already had, but still needing something more tangible for his story, Payne asked a direct question. Had she seen any of the men who had committed the murder? Payne later wrote, "She seemed afraid to talk. She said, however, that Bill had seen some of them." Given what he had already witnessed along with the fact of William's absence, Payne knew that there wasn't much more to be gleaned for his story from this location. Besides, he had already seen enough that morning to file his first dispatch with the newspaper. But to do this, he would have to get himself back to London. Upon leaving the house, he again noted an inordinate number of footprints surrounding the property. As Payne made his way toward London, members of the local constabulary were starting to investigate the crime scenes. Back on the Roman line, County Constable George Walter Clay was looking to conduct a few interviews of his own, and while there was a general attitude of both shock and empathy for the murdered family among most of the people in the community, Constable Clay learned that there were also those within several of the neighbouring farmhouses who were of a far less sympathetic disposition toward the Donnellys. According to Clay, "Going from house to house, I came across a young woman of the name of Farrell. She stated that she was glad they were killed, for the Donnellys had killed her father some years ago, and now she laughed that they would not do any more harm as they were out of the way. Farther down the Roman line, a young man whose name I found out to be Carroll came up to me and wanted to know who I was. I did not inform him, but said I was a stranger from Toronto. Then he spoke up and said, 'You damn strangers had better look out, or you will get a few bullet holes in your hearts.'" The constable could not have picked 2 more significant people to converse with regarding the Donnelly tragedy, as the young man who had made the threatening comments might well have been James Carroll, a man who would soon be arrested under suspicion of having been the ringleader of the Donnelly murders, while the death of the young woman's father, Patrick Farrell, almost 33 years previously, was believed by most to have been the event that set the wheels of the Donnelly family's destruction into motion. Chapter 2. The Things We Do for Land. In order to see the full picture of what led up to the massacre of the Donnelly family, it is important to know that it was very much the product of a different time and place. Rural Ontario in the 19th century was a rugged environment that bred in its inhabitants a peculiar toughness and ability to endure hardships. Hardships that came at them on a daily basis and with a fury. Nature threatened them with unpredictable weather, unmerciful winters, unyielding soil and wild animals. Neighbours could also pose a danger, not only from diseases such as typhus, that often arrived attached to the new immigrants, but also from the more predatory types among them, who looked to exploit any perceived weakness, and who were almost reflexively hostile and violent to both people and mores that differed from their own. Consequently, one's survival depended upon caution and the cultivation of a strong and well-calloused disposition. And while most residents of the community were church-going folks, that held only for Sundays. The remaining 6 days of the week required an unwillingness to turn the other cheek in matters both in and outside the home. If you had been wronged or suffered an impertinence, you were expected to handle the matter on your own or through your family or members of your group. Appealing to outside agencies such as the police, or what passed for police in those days in these rural areas, or the courts to intervene was viewed as an unnecessary step, particularly when a far more direct solution lay within the power of one's own hands. For example, in June 1879, two farmers in Biddulph had a dispute. Patrick Grouchy Ryder believed that two sons of a fellow community member, Patrick Whalen, had trespassed in an abandoned barn that Ryder owned on the 7th concession. Rather than taking the matter before local magistrates, the two farmers decided to have their sons fight it out. On June 20th, 21-year-old James Ryder and 33-year-old John Whalen met at a designated spot on the Roman line and fought it out in front of a crowd of some 50 of their neighbours for a period of 30 straight minutes. Eventually, John Whalen called out that he'd had enough, at which point the crowd dispersed back to their respective farms. The matter had effectively been settled as per the mores of the community. This was simply how things were handled, and one either chose to make one's peace with that fact, or left the region on account of it. Those who were willing to accept these terms for survival came from all walks of life. The village of Wilberforce, for example, had been settled by former African-American slaves, who had been recently liberated from Cincinnati, Ohio. They had left the United States and arrived into an environment of forests and swamps, and yet through their industriousness and foresight, created a colony with three schools, three sawmills, and a gristmill. Soon more residents began arriving from the American cities of New York, Boston, Rochester, Albany, and Baltimore. By 1835, the 800-acre area boasted a population of between 150 and 200 families. These settlers cleared the land, made roads, and built farms. So successful was the colony that, in time, there was talk of a railway coming through the Wilberforce region, which made the property values of the inhabitants soar in the eyes of speculators. With the potential of escalating property values came envy from their neighbours, the Irish Protestants, who begrudged the freemen not only their superior land, but also their timing, as the Americans had been the first to arrive in the region and therefore had first opportunity to claim the prime pieces of real estate. Soon a concerted effort was made to drive the African Americans from the region. Barns and homes were burned and families threatened and assaulted. After a while, the constant exposure to such hostilities, along with the superior opportunities for earning money that beckoned from nearby Canadian and American cities, saw the Wilberforce black population diminish into virtual non-existence. At the same time that the African-American population was withdrawing from the region, the Irish Roman Catholic population was arriving. And this too posed a threat to the Irish Protestants, who knew firsthand what the problems had been between these two factions back in their native Ireland. And both groups, it seemed, were quite prepared to continue these problems on the soil of their new homeland. And so the troubles continued. And they were troubles for which the weak of spirit had no stomach. It was natural law and survival of the fittest and most ruthless that held sway. And so it would remain until civilization, which is merely social restraint mutually agreed upon for group survival, could find anchorage. However, in 1846, civilization had not yet taken root in the rural communities, and the various factions within those communities manufactured and held to their own rules of conduct in order to ensure the survival and protection of their respective groups. But in all cases, the potential upsides, freedom, the rights to the fruits of one's own labour, however modest, and a chance at a future, were weighed in the balance against the adversity to be encountered, and were found by most to be well worth the price to be paid in sweat, tears, and blood. This was the new world that waited to greet James and Joanna Donnelly and their firstborn son, James Jr., along with tens of thousands of other Irish immigrants, when they stepped off their ship from the Emerald Isle and onto the shores of Gros Isle, one of the principal landing points for immigrants from Ireland in the province of Quebec. To reach Gros Isle was something of an accomplishment in itself, as thousands of would-be immigrants from Ireland perished during the voyage. By some estimates, as many as one out of every five would die en route to Canada. Still more expired during the quarantine period that followed their arrival. Truly, so high was the death rate among the new arrivals that their vessels of transportation were commonly referred to as coffin ships. By June 1847, it was reported that 40 of these ships, packed with 14,000 Irish immigrants, were lined up for 2 miles along the St. Lawrence River, waiting to dock with their sickly passengers. While a good number of these new arrivals opted to remain in Quebec, others ventured east to the maritime provinces of Nova Scotia, Prince Edward Island, New Brunswick, the point of landing there being Partridge Island, and Newfoundland. The bulk of the Irish immigrants, however, chose to travel a further 500 or so miles west to the province of Ontario, in what was then called Upper Canada. The 2,730-mile ocean voyage lasted some 3 months, which provided the ambitious settlers plenty of time to envision what their new future could be. No matter what hardships lay before them, these people felt ready for the task that awaited them on these far shores. They looked ahead with hope, a commodity that was non-existent in the life that they had left behind, for they had been promised land that, with sufficient sweat equity, they might one day own for themselves. This held high appeal. In Ireland, the Roman Catholics were second-class citizens. They could work the land of their Protestant masters, who in turn bent their collective knees to their British superiors. But even they.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.